All right, welcome to Alabama Gristmills. Good to have you join us today. We've got a, I'm your host, Mike Causey, with my co-host, Donna Causey. How are you doing this morning?
Doing great. Good day today.
Yeah.
And we're good, but this is a good one.
That's good. Well, our story today kind of ties into the Alabama Bicentennial that's going on now, the 200th anniversary, right?
Right. And if you want to start trying to go to sites that are involved in the Bicentennial, you have to go to this place. So in Washington County is where it is.
St. Stephen's. Yeah. And just north of Mobile, right. In Washington County.
Yeah, there's nothing there at Old St. Stephen's but a national park now. Alabama Historical Commission is researching it, but it's where Alabama started.
Yeah, so the actual town's kind of turned into a ghost town. Am I right there? Is that correct? Right.
Well, there's not even any houses left in the old St. Stephen's. Actually, there's two St. Stephen's. I'm going to get into that down the story, but that gets kind of confusing. But the main thing is this Washington County, believe it or not, is a small county, a small rural county, and it had 9 county courthouses. Can you believe that?
Well, that's a lot of legislation going down and laws for such a small little area. That's for sure.
It didn't used to be small, but it is now. So, but we'll get into that in the story.
Before we do that, I do want to mention a way to support us. What we're doing is become a patron of the AlabamaPioneers.com and the podcast here, and it helps us get all the research done and the stories out to you. And you can do that for the price of a cup of coffee or less than a cup of coffee a month. So,
really, and it will help us tremendously.
Yes, it all adds up and helps us get this done and keep this all this information coming out steadily. And
And on top of that, you get to be first with all the stories, extra benefits. You get some free books. We provide other things as patrons. You can go to it and find out the different tiers you can join at, you know. So all of them will help down the line. Everything you do will help.
Absolutely. And of course, we've got the series of books, the Alamo Footprints books, where you can purchase those. And that, again, goes directly to what we're doing here. So you can find those at Amazon.com. So anything out there, then the cheapest way, the freest way is you can just give us a review on the iTunes or in your player of the podcast. That's true. Also help us out as well. So just kind of spread the word about what we're doing here. Let's go ahead and get in the story with that out of the way.
Okay.
Tell us about the beginning of Alabama and the town of St. Stephen's are the two towns that I guess you're going to go over.
Right, even more than that. We're going to talk about 9.
All right. Well, give us a little story about St. Stephen's.
Washington County, anyway. We'll start with Washington County because it's a county that many people may not be aware of other than they know that that's where St. Stephen's is. Washington County is bounded by Choctaw County to the north, the Tom Bigbee River to the east, and across which lie Clark and Baldwin counties, is by Mobile Bay to the south and by the state of Mississippi to the west. And the county seat today is located at Chatham in Washington County. And this Old St. Stephen's was the capital of the Alabama Territory. So that's why we keep mentioning St. Stephen's. It was the first capital of the Alabama Territory and the only capital. The ruins of the former capital now lie across the river above Jackson, yet the city was probably the largest in the state in early days, even though there's no buildings left there now. There were actually two St. Stephen's, the territory's capital called Old St. Stephen's, which does not have any buildings, and New St. Stephen's, which is only a few miles away. And if you want to start your bicentennial trail, that's the place to start. Washington County has a lot of history. The area of present-day Washington County was claimed by Spain as part of Florida from 1519 to 1700. And it was governed by France as part of Louisiana from 1700 to 1763, taken from France by England in 1763 and held by England until the end of the Revolutionary War, when it was again claimed by Spain. So you can see Washington County has had a lot of different countries and a lot of nationalities involved in its existence from the very beginning. With the Treaty of Lorenzo in 1795, Spain agreed to withdraw to the 31-degree line. And in 1798, the United States then created the Mississippi Territory, which included Washington County and Georgia. And they relinquished all claims to the lands in Alabama and Mississippi in 1802. At that time, there were two population centers in the Mississippi Territory, one on the Mississippi River and the other of the Tombigbee and the Alabama Rivers. Washington County was in the Tombigbee District, which was created June 4, 1800, by Governor Winthrop Sargent of the Mississippi Territory. And on June 4, 1800, by proclamation of Governor Winthrop, Washington County was created. It is the oldest of the counties in Alabama, and it's embraced between the Chattahoochee and the Pearl Rivers. As of 2010, the population was only 17,581 in the whole county, but it was a booming place back in the early days. Washington County originally had an area of 300 miles one way and 88 the other. Of course, it's condensed quite a bit since then. 16 counties in Mississippi and 29 in Alabama were formed wholly or in part of its original domain. The lower part of its present area was taken from Baldwin County in 1820. From 1830 to 1847, it was about 70 miles in length, but the five northern tiers of townships were taken to form Choctaw. The county originally had 26,300 square miles, but today contains only 1,081 square miles. And the population, according to 2010 United States Census, was 17,581. Of course, you can tell by the name that it was named after President George Washington. The first settlement within the area now known as Washington County was made at Old St. Stephens, and it was the first territorial capital, like I mentioned before. The county courthouse was moved several times. The first civil courts in the county were held at McIntosh's Bluff in 1803, which was several miles above the junction of the Tombigbee and the Alabama Rivers in 1803. The site was near the American-built Fort Stoddard on the Tombigbee River, about 2 miles east of the town of McIntosh. Today, only a few foundation blocks remain on that site. John Collar, Cornelius Rain, and John Johnson were presiding at the time of the first court meeting. McIntosh Bluff, which you read about many, many times in history, Alabama history, was an English grant. It was the tract of land so-called having been given by the King of England to Captain John McIntosh, who was connected with the Army of West Florida. John McIntosh had a son who became a British officer and a daughter born in Georgia. This daughter went to England, and she married a British officer named Troop and returned to Mobile and went up the river in a barge to her father's residence, which is kind of romantic. Way to go. There in 1780 at McIntosh Bluff was born a son who bore the name of George M. Troop and who became in after years a distinguished governor of Georgia, one of the vigorous political writers of his age. The McIntosh family were Scotch Highlanders, and while one branch had its representatives in the British Army, other members of the family, citizens of Georgia, were zealous Whigs during the Revolution. Among these were Colonel John and General Lackland McIntosh, the latter having come to the Georgian colony when a boy with Oglethorpe, which is a well-known name in Georgia, its founder. The courthouse was next moved to Wakefield. Boundaries of the county were redrawn in 1809, and Wakefield became a part of Baldwin County, and the Washington County Courthouse had to be moved because they didn't have a capital for Washington County. They moved it to Franklin in 1810. So that's the third move it had. Old St. Stephens continued to grow, and it became the fourth county seat with the official designation as courthouse when an act was passed December 23, 1815, because it was a larger area. A.P. Lipscomb, Joseph McCarty, James Thompson, Hugh Timman, John Harris, Francis Boykin, and John Womack were some early names, and they were appointed in 1815 to choose the site for the courthouse. This St. Stephen's today is referred to as Old St. Stephen's, as it's located approximately 2 miles north of the present town site. It became the capital of the Alabama Territory in 1817, and of course, as the capital, it grew rapidly. It emerged as a center for political and commercial activity in the new Alabama Territory for that 1 year that Alabama was a territory. By 1818, it had a population of 1,500, which is astounding for that time period, and it boasted the location of the territorial legislature, a federal land office, the Washington Academy, the state's first charter school, and an Indian trading factory, and the Tombeck Mead Bank, a steamboat company, numerous merchants, and several other physicians resided in Old St. Stephen's. By 1819, it boasted it had 500 homes, and that's a very early date to have that many homes in one settlement. There were approximately 20 stores and commercial establishments, which included 2 hotels, legal and medical office, and even a theater, believe it or not, during that time. It also became the location of one of the state's earliest Masonic lodges, it possibly as early as 1811. A partial description of Fort St. Stephen's was given by a law enacted in 1807 for laying out a town in Washington County near Fort St. Stephen's. The streets were to be not less than 100 feet wide. That's a pretty wide street. On the lands of Edwin Lewis, John Baker, James Morgan, and John F. McGrew. These men were also appointed missioners to lay out the town. But still, you know, even though a lot of English Europeans were settled in the area, Spaniards still resided in the area too. But they became annoying to the English citizens, and they set out on an expedition to drive them out. But because they were becoming more and more wanting their country, America, to become great, but they were not too successful. And so they went back home and decided to leave the Spaniard expulsion to the general government instead of just a few people from Washington County. The prosperity of St. Stephen's declined over the years for several reasons. Steamboat that could navigate upriver beyond St. Stephen's became prevalent, so people went further inland. The acquisition of Mobile by the United States in 1813 made it the port of entry, and Mobile was included in the Mississippi Territory in 1813. Even though it had been settled much earlier, it did not belong to the United States so before then, so it could not be part of included as one of the earliest settlements. The population had dwindled to roughly 300 people by then, once the port changed. The city of Mobile was included in the Alabama Territory in 1817. That really hurt the old St. Stephen's in their population growth. And of course, the removal of the Alabama Territory capital to a more central location at Cahaba in 1818 really hurt it, because the federal land office and the trading factory kind of disappeared after that time. The final blow, of course, was the spread of a yellow fever epidemic in 1819, which killed as many as 700 people. And at that time, yellow fever was believed to be caused by vapors from swamp areas, so they moved away from the riverbank and didn't want to be located near there. And of course, with the steamships and coming up in Mobile, a lot of that traffic went in that direction instead of St. Stephen's. The town of Old St. Stephen's was eventually deserted, and today it's a forested area. And the Consolidated Tribe and the Mobilians kept up their tribal organization until the coming of the English, at which time they were practically absorbed into the bulk of the Choctaw people. Even though the U.S. government removed most of Choctaw and Creek to the Indian Territory, or Oklahoma, west of the Mississippi River in the 1830s, some of the Native Americans remained behind and decided they wanted to become American citizens. They were allowed to do that. In 1979, Alabama recognized the MOWA, the Mobile and Washington County Band of Choctaw Indians. Its members are concentrated along the border of Mobile and Washington counties. A very famous historic event did occur in Washington County in 1807 that we spoke about earlier. It happened about 5 miles west of McIntosh's Bluff when Captain Edmund P. Gaines, the commandant of Fort Stoddard, and a file of soldiers met and arrested Colonel Aaron Burr, ex-Vice President of the United States. He was kept in honorable captivity at the fort for over 2 weeks and sent to Richmond, Virginia, where he was tried and acquitted of treason against the United States. That was a big event, and we talked about that in another podcast, so you could look back into that and see that he was arrested there. So Washington County has played a significant role in the state of Alabama in many respects. The Washington County Museum today preserves the history of the county with many collections. And as you go into the museum building, you can realize that was the courthouse that was built in 1853, which has been beautifully restored. The showpiece in the museum is a 750-year-old native canoe that was discovered on the Tom Bigby in 1973. Other exhibits include antique cooking utensils, vintage clothing, military memorabilia, and equipment used in the timber and the turpentine industries, which became very, very prevalent in the area.
Well, that was a pretty amazing story of the birthplace of Alabama, and it was, you know, the fact that you could see how the politics of the time and how dynamic the society was by the courthouse moving around like it did.
Right. I mean, you go in that area, you don't think all those small towns have significance, but they do. They were actually the courthouse.
Yeah. It's crazy how, you know, nowadays everything's pretty much set. You know, the courthouse does not move. You know, you don't hear that happen at all. But in the early days and the growth of the area, it was necessary in a lot of cases just because the lines were redrawn and being in the wrong spot, and then the political power of the different little towns pulling that. So it's pretty fascinating that how dynamic it was.
It's fascinating, and you don't realize. I mean, we go down there and you see Old St. Stephen's and you see the museum, but go and visit some of the other towns. You'll learn a little bit more because there's deep history in a lot of those little towns since it was a hugely it was a major settlement area.
Right. It's a pretty area too. It's really beautiful down there.
Oh, it is beautiful.
It's kind of
down
like a sleeper in Alabama, you know, that you don't think about to go visit.
Yeah, a lot of people go to Oklahoma because it was, the first capital after it became a state. But that little area lasted a long time from the early 1800s to 1819. There was a lot of history that took place in that as the beginning of it when we were a part of the Mississippi Territory and then on more when we became part of Alabama Territory for 1 year. So you can pick up quite a bit of information from locals in there. In the area today.
And like you said in the story, St. Stephen's Historical Park is a good place to start out. And that's where all that the building is and the history. So if you want to get down there, that's a good place to look out and get a little dose of history there.
Well, you know what's so interesting too is amazing that courthouse that was built and became a Masonic Lodge and then was restored and become a museum now. It was built in 1853, and you think of all the hurricanes and weather and storms and tornadoes we've had, and it still exists, you know.
Yeah.
It's one of those few things that we're thankful, and it's close to the coast down there, so it's kind of dangerous that it's in a dangerous area. So it's amazing. So be sure and get the opportunity to go down there and visit it.
And they've even got cabins and campgrounds down there that you can stay at the park there, so it makes it, you can do it a little overnight. Kind of see the area and tour around and see the different towns. So,
right,
definitely a great place to visit and check out the birthplace of the beginning of Alabama. And also, I mean, in addition to the campgrounds and everything, they do have areas for kids. They've got, you know, a water slide down there. It's like a 51-foot long water slide. So it's a horseback riding, fishing, and boat rentals, things like that. So you can definitely make a day or two out of it down there and have a lot of fun in the
Oh, yeah. More than just seeing the historic sites, you can have a vacation there, can't you?
Right, because you got the old town there to, you know, check out and walk through the streets of the old town, do the recreational park, do the museum, camping. Sounds like a good weekend.
Yeah, well, how often do you see a 750-year-old native canoe, too? I mean, that's pretty amazing that you could see in the courthouse.
Not every day, that's for sure.
Yeah, a lot of history in the area.
Next events they've got coming up, they got some things coming up in September. They have their annual rubber duck race, so that'll be something to check out. And then a special fall lunch and learn at the old Washington County Courthouse.
Oh, that would be fun.
Some things. And then the big on October 15th, the old St. Stephen's Day. So got some things coming up you can check out. So kind of put those on your calendar if you want to go on a special day.
Yeah.
But any day, it would be good to go visit down there as well.
Yeah, take a vacation in Alabama for once.
Well, with that, we'll go ahead and finish this episode up. Thanks for everybody joining us. And like we always say, share the podcast out. You know, if you know somebody that's interested in the history of Alabama and these little tidbits. Always appreciate that. Any feedback, just let us know. We'd love to hear from everybody. And we'll let Red Foley play us out with a little Alabama Jubilee this time. Until next time.
One-legged Joe dancing round on his toes. Throws away his crutch and hollers. He let her go, oh honey.